Discospondylitis occurs when there's an infection that happens at the end plates of the backbones or the vertebral bodies, and they sit right next to the disc space. The causes of discospondylitis are often bacterial in nature, so things like E. coli, Staphylococcus, and Streptococcus are the most common bacteria that we can culture. Generally, these bacteria can also be found in the bloodstream or the urine of the patient. We don't exactly know why this infection gets into these end plates, but hematogenous or kind of a blood-borne spread is the most likely cause. Generally, the young, large breed male working class dogs tend to be the most common that we see develop discospondylitis, but all genders, breeds, and ages can be affected. The most common symptoms of discospondylitis in veterinary patients generally includes pain along the spinal column. So they can show signs of pain in really different ways. So sometimes they'll be vocal if you touch around their back. They can have hiding behaviors. They can be unwilling to move or walk, or just not willing to do their normal daily activity. In cases where the discospondylitis has become more advanced, neurological signs can be seen. Most common being weakness in the legs of the patient, in coordination in the way the patient's walking, or in severe cases, you can get paralysis of the limbs. Patients that are suspected to have discospondylitis should have full physical and neurological evaluations. Sometimes evidence of fever can be present, pain, and varying neurological signs depending on the location of the infection. If discospondylitis is suspected based on the patient's signalment, exam, and history, radiographs or x-rays of the spine can be helpful in finding the lesions. The full spinal column should be imaged because discospondylitis can be in multiple areas at once. Evidence of discospondylitis on the radiographs or x-rays generally include collapsed disc spaces or sometimes even widened disc spaces. And the end plates of the vertebrae are generally destroyed or irregular instead of being sharply marginated. Sometimes evidence of discospondylitis can't be seen on the x-rays or radiographs alone, and this happens especially if you catch the disease early. In these cases, CT imaging or even MRI imaging of the spine would be needed to detect the more subtle changes. After the imaging has been performed and discospondylitis is suspected, we have to try to find which infectious organism is at fault. So things like blood cultures, urine cultures, CT or ultrasound-guided biopsies can all be performed to try and look for the bacteria or the fungus that's causing the problem. There are four big categories when we're treating patients with discospondylitis. The first one is pain management. We want to make sure that these patients receive either anti-inflammatory or nerve pain medications to help cope with the pain associated with the disease. Generally, we can take the pain medications away over a few weeks to months as the patient starts to recover. The next big category is antibiotics or antifungal medications. Depending on which infection is actually causing the discospondylitis, we want to make sure that we culture for bacteria or perform blood tests so that we can pick the right antibiotic or antifungal to treat. The treatment process itself can take at least up to 6 months, but generally up to a year of treatment is needed because it's very hard to clear the infection from the bone itself. As we're treating and we slowly start to remove our medications, relapses of the infection can also happen. The third major category is rest and activity restriction. Patients that have discospondylitis may develop vertebral fractures or spinal luxations, and so we want to keep them in a small enclosed area and keep them rested at least for the next several weeks to make sure we can avoid those complications. The final is follow-up appointments with your veterinary neurologist. So patients diagnosed with discospondylitis are generally rechecked fairly frequently to monitor for neurological improvement, improvement in their pain, and sometimes repeat imaging and repeat cultures are needed to make sure that we can clear the infection. The prognosis for patients that are diagnosed with discospondylitis are generally fair to good with long-term treatment. Patients can be fair to poor in their long-term prognosis, especially if they're suffering from a fungal infection, if they develop spinal luxations, or if they have severe neurological signs such as paralysis.